Yeah, thank you very much. we are talking about a defense technology, which is called Enclosure Puf for tamper-proofing commodity hardware and other applications. Lars and myself, we are not the only contributors here. For my colleague of us, David, and PhD student of Christoph Paar, Johannes, and Christoph Paar themselves are in this project involved as well. Okay. So we are from Bochum. This is now a little bit advertisement for Bochum. Yeah. So Bochum is well known for the Ruhr University as well as for Nokia and Opel. But as you maybe know, Nokia and of course the HDI, which is part of the Ruhr University. But as you know, Nokia and Opel don't exist anymore. So we founded FISEC to help the city and the ecosystem. This is not true, yeah. But anyway. Okay, so BlackBerry, yeah, it's now VW, yeah, true, yeah. So in Bochum, we are very strong in security and crypto. We have more than 26 professors in security and crypto, and not in the entire university, yeah. Studying in IT security, we produce more than 100 students per year, like Lars, for example, with education in IT security. And which is a difference. So we don't have kind of like a computer science department with a specialty of IT security. The students can actually choose IT security from semester one, which is kind of unique. As FISEC, we are one of a couple of startups in IT security, which also shows that Bochum is a nice ecosystem for IT security startups. So if you are interested building a company or have a young company, come to Bochum. It's a very, very nice ecosystem. We have the Max Planck Institute for Cybersecurity, Digital Privacy, Eurobits, Fluxfingers, and I hope so well known in this community. Okay, so that's it. So now back to the talk. So which is one of the greatest IoT security concerns? And this addresses pretty much the entire conference here because it is the hardware, so it is actually the physical unsecure endpoint. Yeah. And this is also where we are focusing on. And if we are wondering how to prove this kind of attack systems, this is what we are talking today. Yeah. Just maybe as an overview, so we come from this area. So the technology we are presenting was developed for nuclear warhead disarmament scenarios, where we prove the integrity of silos if something was changed or not in the environment for digital verification. Yeah? And this technology, we took this technology and developed it further to use it for machines and now also for IoT devices. Just that you get an idea where we are coming from and you will understand what I'm talking about later in the talk. And if you have questions, then just ask. Yeah? Okay.
Now, so the first thing we are focusing on is what kind of attacks are possible for the physical endpoints. You know, maybe quite much different type of attacks like social engineering, brute forcing, mathematical attacks, but we are only focusing on implementation attacks. So there are active and passive ones, like side channel attacks for passive ones with power analysis, timing attacks, or for active ones, reverse engineering and fault injection. For implementation attacks, you don't need to break the mathematical proofs from normal crypto. So we have simple power analysis, an example here where an RSA key is calculated by different power consumption for square and multiply. You probably know the famous square and multiply algorithm for calculating it very fast. So that's one possibility to read out one RSA key. Another one is fault injection, where you could probably do something like shooting with lasers on operating systems and produce faults in the way you want, like weakening random number generators. So next one is software and hardware reverse engineering. We heard a keynote today about this. So you all possibly know what goals we can achieve with it. Yeah? With enough time and manpower, we can break almost every system with reverse engineering. Another interesting topic is the implementing of hardware trojans. 2017, Christoph Parr from our chair of embedded security was holding a keynote here at Hardware.io about this topic. So it's about implementing trojans in hardware to get to secret cryptographic components. Yeah. So the physical access to those devices enables many attack vectors, and there are goals to achieve with it, like leaking security informations, like cryptographic keys, or tampering devices like ATMs so they react in a not regular way, like giving you all the money they have in it. Just so we want to define some security levels or some security properties for systems, like how to defend them against tampering. There are four different types. One is tamper resistance, where you make it very difficult for the attacker to get to the hardware, like using one-time screws and so on. So we have a few slides later some examples for all of those types. The next one is tamper evidence, where we are want to be notified after an inspection that the system was tampered. Another one is tamper detection, so the system itself can realize, hey, I've got tampered. And the strongest one is tamper responsiveness, so the system reacts to the tamper. Okay. There's also a standard defining security goals or levels. It's NIST FIPS 142. With different levels, so level 4 is the highest of it, which is committed from the US government. The system for level 4 has to detect all possible attacks. It has to zeroize all secure information. It must be separated from the main system and has a complete tamper detection response envelope. So we have approaches for tamper resistance. Therefore, you can do like porting your electronic components so the attacker has it a little bit harder to get to them, like doing the porting away before, can do something like probing or using totally secure one-way screws, because one-way screws you probably cannot remove, they're totally secure. So these things are very cheap, but not so effective, but widely used because they are very useful against things like vandalism in public. Okay, for tamper evidence, we have things like security seals or warranty seals, freshness seals, just seals we notice when they are broken or removed. So we notice, okay, someone has done anything to our system. It's also mostly cheap and not so effective in those ways, but there are also higher approaches for things like nuclear warhead disarmament, where you scan with a laser whole objects to detect more specific changes, like shown here in the picture, reflecting particles you cannot fake in that physical dimension. Another approach is very cheap for tamper evidence is when you want to ship like your laptop from here to the USA, and the person you're sending it to wants to know, okay, no one opened the laptop and inserted things like hardware trojans in the way. You can just use nail polish with glitter in it and put it around all screws and stickers which are covering screws, so you know if you're taking a high resolution picture of it, if someone has broken your seal, because the glitter particles cannot be ordered in the same way again, yeah, like you have done it around it. Yeah, it's kind of random. Okay. For tamper detection, there are also different approaches on the market, like just one-way switches, which are detecting, hey, the case has been opened, yeah, I haven't been tampered. Other ways are sensors for photodiode detectors, which can notify if some light is shining onto the device. So if the device is completely covered and you are opening it, the sensor detects, hey, there's light, I've been opened. Yeah. It's quite complicated to turn the light off and do it again, so the sensor wouldn't notify it. It's yeah. Not the securest way. So the last approach is for tamper responsiveness. There are different approaches, like you can put an electronic mesh around the whole PCB. It's quite expensive, so you cannot put it around a big system. And another issue is that you already always need to have power supply, yeah? Like battery packs and something, because you have to measure continuously the whole time. Those measures for EG are detecting changes in the voltage. So if you try to probe through it, yeah, they will just notify and react to it. So the reactness is to zeroize the storage, which can be not wanted if you have false positive. So no one is tampering your system, but your system says, hey, I'm tampered. I delete myself. So it's yeah, not always the best, and it doesn't work. Yeah, the FIPS 142 level 4 is hard to reach. The certification for it, there are only three HSM modules worldwide who are currently certified. There have been only 40 modules for all time, which has been reached this certification status. Yeah, we have other issues like the constant power need can be troublesome. Like if your device runs out of power somehow when every information is gone, that's not very good. Yeah. Other important things are like we need to retrofit existing machines, which are very very expensive, so we don't want to rebuild it completely in a secure way. We just want to secure it afterwards. And yeah. So to put it all together, we have software and hardware solutions to protect our systems in a physical way. The software solutions are very cheap compared to the hardware solutions, but mostly not so effective like the hardware solutions. Yeah. Yeah, and Christian will present our key idea how to yeah, do it in a more low-cost way.
Yeah. So yeah, as Lars said, he introduced the attacks, the attack vectors, and the problems. Yeah, and he talked about current solutions with the different security levels, all on hardware. And one new approach is based on physical unclonable functions. And from our perspective, it is a very secure version solution which can be achieved with low costs, yeah, because we don't, as you will see later, we don't have to wrap the entire system with complicated meshes. We do it in a different way. Yeah. So now the interesting part starts. Yeah. Okay, so what you need to understand is that there's something called physical disorder-based security. Physical disorder is actually something which is given for any small-scale structure of almost any object, yeah, in a meso- and macroscopical way. So when you take a picture like this of the surface, yeah, then you will see that there are random, imperfect, and pretty unique physical disordered structures. Yeah. So interesting features here are that these structures are actually very hard to duplicate / to clone. Yeah, even if you are the manufacturer, you have a big problem to clone a device on this scale. Yeah. cloning means in this case is first a physical clone, yeah, that we build two physical systems which have the unique is the same surface, for example. Yeah. So the question with respect to this physical unclonal function is now, can we actually use this physical disorder in a constructive way? Yeah, and the answer is yes. Yeah. And this is actually something where a primitive was born called a physical unclonable function. And this is usually something on a silicon level. Yeah, where you use circuits or SRAM or other parts, which has a unique function coming from physical disorder. Yeah, but this can actually run by everything. Yeah, so question is just, what is the stimuli you're using to challenge this the path, and how does the response look like? Yeah. So properties are that a path is, for example, very easy to evaluate, but very hard to predict. Yeah. There's a major difference between something called a strong path and a weak path. It doesn't mean that the weak path is weak. It just relates to the amount of the challenge room. Yeah. So if you have only one challenge or a couple of challenges, then it's a weak path. And if you have a 2^2 exponential room, exponential space of challenge, then it is a strong path, like 128, for example. Yeah. Okay. So important properties of a path is that this fingerprint or this response you get out of the path is robust. Yeah, this is shown in this figure here. So this means if you get at the same challenge at different times to the path, you will get the same response. Yeah. And this holds also for environmental conditions like the temperature change or the system is moving. Or the humidity changes, stuff like this. Yeah? So the response is the same. Yeah? Then we got the feature of unclonability, and this is shown here. So if you add the same challenge to different objects, then you will get completely different responses. Yeah? And the unpredictability says that if you add different challenge to the same path, then you will also get different responses. So these are the major features. Yeah? And then there is an optional feature, which is tamper evidence. And this is something we already learned. Yeah? And tamper evidence means that if someone changes the path in the way that the path is, for example, used as a cover, yeah, and if someone is probing through this path, then he changed the path and the path is kind of destroyed, which means that the challenge response behavior completely changed. Yeah? And if we have these four features, we can actually generate or apply this to a theoretical approach, which is used algorithmic tamper proof. And an algorithmic tamper proof is something which was designed by cryptographers in a very theoretical way, where they say if you want to achieve an algorithmic tamper proof, you need to be able to provide three properties. Yeah? And the properties are first that the hardware that it has a hardware from which an attacker cannot read information. Yeah, so that it has a readout secure storage. The second one is that it has the ability to destroy data, like self-destruction. Like this is what happened every time in Mission Impossible at the beginning. And the third one is that data cannot be changed unnotified, yeah, like a data integrity check. Okay, and this can actually be achieved with a PUF, yeah, because if we say that the PUF is covering the chip, the PCB, or the entire device, then we can extract a response which can be used as a key. And this key can be extracted only from inside, yeah. And if the integrity, so the enclosure, was not manipulated, yeah. And then we get actually a readout secure storage, yeah, which is the physics themselves, yeah. And self-destruction because the physics will change when you penetrate the environment, yeah. And doing so, we can use the key to encrypt stored data, which are integrity protected, and achieve the third property. And this is pretty much the new approach. Yeah? So this means that no digital keys are involved at the beginning. So when the system boots up, it extracts key out of the environment or of a cover. We don't really need trusted hardware in the best case. And we can maybe, depending on the application, retrofit commodity hardware. Yeah. So in this world of PUF-based algorithmic tamper proofs, we have to introduce you to works which are not from us, which are from sort of from the literature. One is was introduced 2006, yeah, which is called coating PUF, where this approach is actually used on the silicon level, where they add some coating and some sensors above the chip and extract keys out of it, yeah, 3 bit per sensor, yeah. In the first talk today, yeah, we had the question, yeah, in the keynote, yeah, where someone asked, what if we just measure the resistance of the circuit, yeah? So measuring the resistance of the circuit is a good add-on to the existing solution, yeah? But if this is deterministic, so if you know the resistance, you can also, you know, you can also just add a resistor and the system is broken again. But if this value of the resistor is random with an entropy, let's say up to 2 to the power of 128 or 128 bit, then it is very hard, yeah, because then the attacker has a huge problem. Yeah? And this is pretty much the same idea here. So putting physical disorder, machine readable on top of the silicon, if someone changes something, he destroys this entropy and the system will figure this out. Yeah? And this happens intrinsically because the responses are used to extract the key, which can be used for crypto operations like encryption, and this key will be destroyed. Yeah? And you don't need to zeroize the cryptographic parameters because they are encrypted. So the same idea, just in a larger scale, was now introduced like 2 weeks ago at CHESS by a group from Munich, where they introduced a tamper-resistant PUF cover, yeah, where they use pretty much the same idea, just adding it in something in kind of a metallic shield, yeah, and they can put it above a PCB and protect the devices below the PCB. Yeah? If they don't produce too much energy or heat, then they say that this is working very well. Okay, so chip level, PCB level, but we say we want to do it on a system level. Yeah? And how do we do it? So a system level from our perspective means that we have a multi-chip embedded system. Yeah, so this means if we secure one chip or one PCB, this might be not enough. Yeah, and the question is, how can we actually tamper-proof complex environments, even like machines? Yeah, maybe an ATM or something like this, yeah? Or maybe a EDU of a car. So again, yeah, what we do is we measure the inner environment. Yeah, we have a prototype here, and we can give a demo later if you want. Yeah. And if we have time, if we don't have time, we do it afterwards. Yeah. So we can show you how we can extract the key out of this electromagnetic fingerprint, and how the key will be destroyed if you just change a little bit of this enclosure. So question now is, how do we do it? So the key idea is here that we use this physical disordered system, machine readable, using electromagnetic wave propagation effects and a cryptographic protocol. Yeah. We are focusing now on this part because this is interesting and the innovation part. So some basics about multi-scale surface models in respect to radio wave propagation. One essential thing you need to know is that as higher the frequency is we use, as deeper and more detailed information we can get out of the physical environment. And this is not just focused like on the surface, it is actually the entire physical system. Yeah, this is completely material dependent, but you can also add or get information which is, for example, inside of something. Okay, so what kind of frequencies do we use? Yeah, because when we have the frequency band, yeah, then we know there are very low frequencies with very high wavelengths, and then there are higher frequencies with low wavelengths. But what we learned are that changes in the environment are sometimes super small. Yeah. And there are actually no official information, even for this level 4 NIST standard, how an attack really looks like, because they are usually classified. Yeah. This means that they say if anything happens to the enclosure, the system must theorize the keys. Yeah. But nobody says what kind of attack happened. Yeah. And what is pretty well known is that the systems or the security for chip and PCB level security is about 300 micrometers. Yeah. So if you have a probe or a drill with 300 micrometers, you have to secure the system against this. And this is actually possible with this technology. Yeah. But now the question is, how can we do it? Because people maybe know there's a rule that radio waves interact with objects if they are in the size of the wavelengths. Yeah, and we are not in the size of the wavelengths even if we go here in the terahertz area. Yeah, so how is this possible? Yeah? And this is pretty actually one of the first innovations here, which is pretty nice. And the idea was also introduced by some guys from Microsoft Research. Because if you use a near field of the system, you get a resolution which is not by lambda, by the wavelengths, by the thousandths of the wavelengths. Yeah? And then you can actually go down to, in our case, 60 micrometers. Yeah? So near field models are complicated. Yeah, the thing maybe you need to you can take home, yeah, is that the reactive near field, so the closed near field, the relationship between the field components is often too complex to predict. Yeah, so this means that even for simulation tools, you will see that the resolution where the characteristics of an antenna can completely change if something in the near field environment has a change of a thousandth of the wavelengths. Yeah. Okay. The second thing is that we use channel impulse responses, which is in communication engineering a very standardized thing, how to estimate a physical channel. And this is actually be done by sending an ultra wideband impulse and then measure the change of the impulse when the impulse is walking through the environment and bouncing around and stuff. Okay. So the system architecture here looks like this. Yeah, so we have a digital and analog domain. The digital domain does some time synchronization and then have a couple of ultra-wideband transmitter and receivers and sends these pulses, the signals And on the other side, we have some transceivers which receive the signals and estimate the channel. Yeah. And then we do some pre-processing. We do some feature extraction. Then we do this fingerprint extraction, and then we do key extraction using fuzzy extractors. Yeah. And then at the end here, we get a key, which can be used as introduced. Yeah. In our general system, we have a multiple antenna solution, which can be compared to a MIMO system, where we get actually a complex channel matrix of the channel, yeah? And this represents the enclosure. Yeah, so we have an efficient bandwidth of about 6 gigahertz, which is pretty big, and fingerprint is dependent on how we how we use the system, also very big. Yeah. So, for example, if we estimate the integrity of a system every millisecond for the whole day, then we will generate several terabytes of data. Yeah. Okay. For pre-processing, we use different approaches. The classical approach are, I guess, pretty known, with pattern detection and alignment algorithms, and then just using some correction algorithms to, you know, reduce the noise and handle the alignment and stuff like this, and which is maybe not known to you, is second order statistics using cyclostationary features. And maybe just to tell you a little bit about this. So maybe you know a classical autocorrelation function where you can actually calculate the power density spectrum of a time series. Yeah? And if you want to do this in a second order way, then you add the cyclic prefix here, and then you get something which is called spectral correlation density. Yeah? If you want to know what this is, then you will, yeah. So, and this, the difference here is actually that the classical power density spectrum is actually just the spectrum for a cyclic frequency of zero. Yeah, this means there are no second order statistics. So this is the red part is the classical information you usually get in signal processing. Yeah? But if you use a second order cyclostationary feature evaluation, then you get all the cyclic information, and they are introducing you information of the time behavior, which are completely noise free, yeah? Because the noise doesn't correlate with itself. And this non-zero alpha frequencies introduce very interesting features we are using. Yeah? Because as you might know, a system like a server has rotating things, like a fan, for example, yeah, or an HDD or something like this. And everything which has a cyclostationary statistics is something we handle with this kind of signal processing. Okay. Another important thing in our technology is that we always need to know the temperature. So this means the system behavior and the environmental behavior change dramatically with temperature change. Yeah, and the temperature change are usually with like 1 degree Celsius. So therefore, we use a couple of different approaches dependent on the environment to correct this behavior. Yeah, this is an important thing. Okay, and when we did this, yeah, so we have the pre-processing done, get a stable radiometric device profiles, then we evaluate this fingerprints with respect to 3 different properties. The first property is the key quality, which means how much entropy does the key contain. And this is a research topic by themselves, because how to estimate entropy and randomness is very complicated and dependent on a stochastical model and stuff like this. In our case, we use non-IID estimators and worst-case estimators to estimate the entropy of our response, because signals like this from the nature, they are non-IID, they are non-identical and independent distributed, even if in theory this might be given, in practice this is not given. Yeah. So we use non-IID estimator, and if the system provides entropy above 120 bit, and 120 bit, by the way, doesn't mean that the entire fingerprint contains 128 bit. It means that a change due to an attack changes 128 bits. Yeah. Okay. So if this is given, which is also related to the other ones, we evaluate the reliability and the tamper sensitivity. So this means for different mechanical shocks. So someone is, you know, kicking against the device by an ATM. This is actually possible. Yeah. By a server. I don't know. Some system admins here, I guess everyone kicked against the server. Sounds fun. Anyway, so, but it's not the, yeah, whatever. So, dependent on the legitimate behavior, the reliability and the tamper sensitivity needs to be evaluated. And, spoiler, if you want to secure the system against 300 micrometer attacks, then you cannot drop the system from 2 meters or something like that. Yeah? Because the mechanical shock will be destroy the environment. So then you need to maybe use other transportation versions, like not the classical UPS, because then they drop it really by 1 meter, and use other ones. Yeah, and this is, there's a causality between sensitivity and reliability. Okay, but at the end we want to get something like this, where we have something called an intradistance of the key of the raw key material, which is small. So the bit error rate is small and can be corrected by our fuzzy extractors. And if an attack occurs, the bit error rate is high. Yeah. Of course, the best one would be if the bit error rate would be 0.5, but you can work with this as well. Yeah, this is something where we have to tune the fuzzy extractor. And what the fuzzy extractor actually does, and the fuzzy extractor is here given by the information reconciliation, is that it corrects the bits in a way that the response after an attack will be useless. Yeah, privacy amplification is actually hashing. Yeah, so this means we get the fingerprints. We quantize them, we do information, we do error correction, we do hashing until we get enough entropy, and then we have a key where the reference, you know, the one during enrollment and the later one are identical. Yeah. And to understand this maybe in an information theoretical way, we extract something called a secret key capacity or a secret key rate, which is, this is the reference fingerprint. This is a fingerprint, let's say, by another temperature, but everything is fine. And this is after an attack. Yeah. And this, what is left over here, this is a secret key capacity. Yeah. And in this case, we have here the secret key capacity is about 180,000 bits. Yeah. So this is, from our perspective, this is, it's okay. Yeah. And this is given by worst case estimators. Okay. So a high level, High level overview. We have a classical host system. We have our hardware, which extracts the key, provides a key or uses a key internally to decrypt stuff and then sends heartbeats afterwards. We introduced testbed 1, which was a very low-cost version because we want to show how to do it in under 100 euro. Yeah, we used a very this is like 1 euro. This is like 50 euro, and we can detect 300 micrometer attacks. Yeah. If you turn on a van, it doesn't work anymore, but if you have it in a stable environment, it actually works. Yeah. Okay, another example are servers. Unfortunately, we can't show the real solution we developed for customers, so we brought a testbed just to show you, and this is something we can also show you later. Yeah. So because of time, we can't do it immediately, but later in the social networking event, this 30 minutes, we will be here and show you whatever you want. Okay, another example are electric meters. So here we have a communication unit usually. This is a unit with our technology. This is a classical meter, and this is where the cables are. If you are a smart attacker, what do you attack to, you know, reduce your bill? Probably not use a FIP on the chip. You just disconnect this. Yeah. So, and how do you want to figure this out? And this is a solution we developed here to figure out how, if the seals are still there. Yeah. this is a bank statement printer. Here you can already see what we did. So we add to the, because the idea here was just to secure the data on the computer that nobody can add the USB stick or something to it. so the computer is in a mesh and in a Kappa mesh, so that air comes in and out, and we use this additional enclosure to verify the integrity of this computer. We did the same for an ATM. ATM is super complex, and this is not easy, so we cannot extract the key out of an ATM. Yeah, we do something else. This is what I show you later. Yeah? But this is kind of this old ATM with a standard computer. This is a lock system, yeah, an analog lock system. So they print everything twice, yeah, to figure out what happened. So this is a super old one, but they are very often used. Yeah? And I jump over this. So what we changed to handle this kind of complex systems is that we use features and profiles and send them during the production or during after installation into a reference database and verify the integrity of these systems remotely. And if the system passes, the remote platform sends credentials to the object, or maybe say something like, okay, this is okay or this is not okay. Yeah, what we do here is we use machine learning to extract, to combine the features. The amount of data is pretty much. We are actually searching for a cooperation partner to add this physical layer solution to other intrusion detection systems. So if one is here and want to collaborate, talk to us. Yeah. So we compress the data and then we decide what's going on. We developed three versions here. So an anomaly detection variant and a classification and a classical information theoretical assessment to introduce a layer on the above, yeah, to assess the integrity of the hardware and if wanted to temper response to attacks on the enclosure. Yeah. And just spoiler, most people don't want a temper response. Yeah. Even this is the securest way. The availability is usually more important than the security. Okay, summarizing, you probably didn't learn anything about attacks because you know them very well. And maybe you learned something about countermeasures and you learned about this new countermeasure which can be retrofit to existing solutions. Yeah. This was our very first testbed. This is this for the nuclear disarmament. This is our team. We are looking for cooperation. So talk to us if you are interested in this. And thank you for your attention.